Thanks, Anish. Thank you very much for that. I think a very interesting topic we picked around here. I think while we see the domestic e-commerce boom in a very, very large in India, the global cross-border numbers are also actually very, very large. So I was trying to figure for this where they are going, and research shows that it's close to about $500 trillion already of cross-border e-commerce globally, of course, dominated by US and China. India still fairly small on that scale, near about a 2 billion, 2.5 billion kind of number, but expected to double in the next 5 years pretty clearly. And driven by a lot of factors, especially global exposure and desire as consumers get on to more and more onto the digital world, they get exposed to more and more products they want. There is a demand for authentic and indigenous products from the country of origin rather than buying it locally, which it may not be. And also, simply availability of cheaper product from low-cost countries. There is, which is why China you see at the top of this commerce. And it has been growing, of course, facilitated by players like Amazon, Alibaba, eBay, JD, who have invested significantly to both improve customer experience on the cross-border side, as well as logistics and infrastructure to solve speed of delivery, to solve damaged goods, frauds, returns. I'm sure lots of these are new words for people who've tried their hand at cross-border e-commerce already. And today what we have, I think, is a very, very illustrious and eminent panel, I think, of three businesses that have been both trying their hands at international commerce and represent different categories of building consumer franchise in these global markets. So I'll maybe start with Palak, with you. Just building, and I think it'll be interesting to hear each of your stories of how you've taken the brand into international e-commerce, waded through some of the, when did you decide as a brand to go out into the international market, start international commerce per se, and what has really been your experience? How has it been different? What are the big challenges? Have you been able to build a consumer franchise outside? Just hearing your experience would be great before we get.
So my brand started in 2012, and we started with our store in Delhi, and then eventually we had about we now have about 5 stores, but we only started focusing on e-commerce a year before actually COVID hit, because my vision had always been to sort of create a space and give everyone a slice of the market and make everyone experience what buying textiles is, and just 1 second, please. My whole idea was to have people experience Indian textiles sitting at their homes. So why only give everyone a taste of Ikaya or a taste of Indian textiles only the people who can visit our stores? So the idea was for me to create a virtual store, and not just any e-commerce. I wanted to create a virtual store where anyone sitting in any part of the world can get the Ikaya experience sitting at home. They can understand the kind of customer service that we bring, or the kind of fabric touch and feel. And I'm still trying to get the fabric touch and feel at this point of time. But my idea was to get all the questions that people ask at the store and have them answered online. And I feel like I luckily started off 1 year before COVID hit. And as everyone knows, e-commerce takes a lot of time to pick up. I remember the first website that I built was built only for one person, and that the minute I launched it, it went bust. Then the second website had its own problems. And then luckily, as luck would have it, thank God, the minute COVID hit, I was in a good place to expand, and my website was very robust at that point in time. So we ended up getting that. And the idea was always to make people not just do mere e-commerce, but for me to let them get a taste of real India, and for me to get them to really experience the beauty of buying Indian textiles internationally, so that they don't feel like they're missing out on something. It's been about, I think, 3 years for me since I've been functioning online, and it's been a beautiful experience. We're learning every single day. It's not as easy and direct as your brick and mortar store, because at brick and mortar you understand everything, and online you don't understand everything. Like, it's like you're at your developer's whims and fancies, but you learn. So it's been a beautiful experience. I definitely do want to capture more of the market, and I think through my sub brand Ekaya Thaan, I do want to sort of target international audience sitting abroad as well. For them to give a piece of India to them wherever, in whatever form they must. So that's my vision for the brand, and that's my journey so far.
That's interesting. Very much. Thanks, Pal. Thanks for that. I think we'll delve into some more of that. I think it sounds very, very interesting in terms of what you're trying to build and as a franchise. And I'm sure it's, you know, tough to build a luxury franchise with a touch and feel experience in a global market where you don't have brick and mortar. Right? So getting consumers to relate to the product and you know, build that down. How's that been for you? Is it largely marketing? Are you sort of going offline with it, and how are you building on the franchise?
I mean, it's mainly digital marketing, but we're also sort of using our offline database to amplify it more, because we're even encouraging our offline database to buy online. So we also get feedback. So even during COVID, when they were not able to come, we tried to sort of deliver that experience online. So maybe book your appointment service or video call, and like trying to get that human element to Ekaya, which is what I'm trying to do with my thing. But of course, I mean, it's mostly, I feel like e-commerce, you can't do without digital marketing. And digital marketing has become very, very important to us. So actually in the bargain, print marketing has gone down. So all the money that I would, you know, initially put into magazines and I'd put into hoardings has now gone on digital. And it's actually helped me in the bargain, because, you know, yes, hoardings help, but we're all, in, you know, starting from our grandmothers to our siblings, everyone's on Instagram and WhatsApp and, you know, Facebook. So really, I mean, it's more cost effective. You know, I much rather put in that 6 lakh that I was initially thinking of in a hoarding. I much rather put it on my digital ad spends. And earlier I would, you know, earlier I think underestimated the power of digital marketing. But when, you know, I mean, I did a very beautiful exercise in the month of July where I had an incognito sale, and the kind of response that we got for the first time was absolutely wonderful. And it was all digital market. We did zero physical marketing. We did zero sort of like, we didn't even make calls at that point of time. So, you know, it's, I mean, like, I feel like more and more effort can be sort of expended on that.
And when did you sort of decide to go international? Was it from the very start of the brand that you, you know, went with international e-commerce as well? As you started e-commerce, you went for global markets as well?
You know, my vision for the brand from day one has been to create India's first international luxury brand. So while I sort of, you know, I mean, you know, you have your Louis Vuittons from France and you have your Hermes and you have your Ferragamos, I want to create India's first luxury brand. So my vision from day one has been to cater to Indian audience, to cater to an international audience. With Ekaya, because we sell more Indian stuff, the obvious audience is always Indian. And also during all my trips when I go international, the Indian audience is very not aware of the current Indian fashion. They are always three seasons back, or they're selling all sorts of rubbish stuff internationally, all sorts of dead stock, as we call it in our market.
Yeah.
And, you know, that kind of, I think, ruins the reputation of our country as well, because what we used to sell three seasons back is now in fashion there. So, I mean, the idea was always to give them a real taste of, you know, what Indian textiles actually is and how beautiful it is and how can we... You know, how we sort of can... make them experience it. So of course going international wasn't, I think it's such a huge market and it's such a hungry market, and now with, you know, e-commerce and with digital marketing, everyone has already gotten to know about all the brands and the fashion trends that are in India at this point of time. So why not make it more accessible to them and at the price that they get them in India? So I don't particularly believe in charging double prices, because I think in the first instinct you have to bring the product to them, make them taste it, you know, make them become addicted to it, and then you can sort of add on the other things eventually. But the idea is to, for them to first give them access to it.
Got it. Excellent. Yeah. Thanks for that. I think we will come back and explore some of that a little more. Samrat, coming to you, I mean, understanding you've sort of always put a global lens on Ayurveda, right? You put a global news lens on Ayurveda as you imagine your business and your brand, your category. And how has been your sort of move towards, if I can say, international markets and or particularly e-commerce? and what's been the journey like for you?
So Anurag, I think, you know, echoing Palak's thoughts, we've been traditionally a very strong offline brand. We actually built our business, we started in 2001, and we opened our first store in Delhi Khan Market in 2004. It was then we realized that we had to build our own distribution system because the Indian retail sector was very nascent at that stage. Yeah. You know, there were very few players, there were department stores, and none of them were really portraying any prestige or luxury at that point. So, like, you know, we were one of the first few brands to actually build our entire distribution system, and that too through our own stores. Even today, every one of our stores is not, it's all company owned, company run, it's not franchised. And I think we've got about 105 stores across about 27 cities now. You know, coming back to e-commerce, actually, we started dabbling. I wouldn't call it e-commerce, but literally on a website in 2011. And we actually put it up because we had so many consumers who came to the country, bought the products, then couldn't figure out how to reorder them. So it was literally set up and put that, and it was very nascent stage again for, you know, internet in this country. And then we started to realize that this could become a complete business model on its own. So we actually started concentrating on it from 2012. And, you know, like Palak, we also went through a very big learning process on understanding how robust a website could be, what the marketing would understand. Digital marketing at that time was, again, very, very nascent. So we've lived, we've learned. You know, before pre-COVID, we managed to, I think, our online business was almost 18% of our business. So the numbers were growing. It's growing very, very fast, almost at a 70% CAGR year on year. So it's a very strong business. Having said that, the competition, the number of brands, the space itself has also intensified greatly over the last few years. So it's been a very interesting understanding and learning. You know, we also realized that being a luxury brand, we are not going down the discounting route. Now, primarily, all of the e-commerce in India is based on discounting, on deals, on GWPs. So, you know, while staying away from that to a certain extent, but yet continuing the growth has been that, you know, that little balance that we've been trying to find. In terms of, you know, it's always had a vision of being domestically strong. Today, I think, you know, we have the largest market share in our category and in our vertical. But the idea was that we know that this is an internationally acceptable brand. You know, so when we did our packaging, when we did our product, when we did our product line, the idea was to actually make it, you know, interesting for a global audience. As a brand, we had decided that we would always be in India for the first few years to make sure we learn, we evolve, you know, whatever mistakes have to be made are made in our home country. And we started looking at going international about 2 years ago, just when COVID hit. So, you know, we had the entire plan ready. We were supposed to launch, you know, in two countries. And it was the traditional approach, you know, opening our flagship stores, doing a combination of a brand.com, looking at a channel partner, so all of that. But now, what we've realized, you know, I mean, while the pandemic has been absolutely distressing for everybody, it's also provided an opportunity. And like exactly what the panel is discussing today, is to look at, you know, strengthening that online launch, looking at it, even doing a pure online launch play. You know, again, like, you know, Palak has said, we have a very touch and feel product. We have a product that has to be, you know, put into the hands of the consumers who can then decide whether they like it or not, because it's, while it's a wonderful business, it's a highly competitive business as well. So, you know, going completely online has its challenges, but it's not something that can't be done. And, you know, we're launching actually in the UK in the next 14 days, and we're doing a pure online launch. So it's been an extremely interesting learning over the last 6 months to understand how we would do online while trying to address consumers' needs offline, right? In terms of driving the business both on our social media platform, driving it both digitally as well as offline without actually opening a store. So there are various things that have come up. And what's also interesting is that, you know, while we all are under the perception that this is a cheaper way of doing things, it's really not that cheap. Today, if you were to actually try to drive business, if you were to actually invest into digital marketing, if you were to actually look at, you know, moving people into your brand.com or even towards a channel partner, given their, you know, their percentages, given the kind of spends that you need to do, it's not a cheap process. the only thing that you actually save on is creating an infrastructure or creating logistics where you would have had to have an online business by renting stores, you know, hiring people, going through that entire process. I think that's what we save. But in terms of spend, I think it's becoming a very expensive proposition online as well.
Interesting. Got it. So good luck with your expansion into UK, and that's from that, I think, definitely. And again, in a category like yours, there would also be regulatory considerations, right? You would need certifications to sell in these markets and pull through. Does it work similar on an online basis, or does that change in any manner if you do brick and mortar versus, is it easier from a regulatory standpoint or as tough for simple centering?
No, there's no difference of whether you sell offline or online. The minute you enter a country, you know, if it's the EU or the UK or the US, you have to follow each and every regulatory environment. The good part is we anticipated this a long time ago. So everything that we've done from production, from packaging, to our ingredients, to our formulations has always been geared towards making sure that the product would be acceptable by, you know, EU standards going forward. So we've right. gone through that entire process, and now every single product is registered in the country.
Great, thanks. Ratan, we will pick on some of these in more detail. I just want to get Rajatan as well and hear his story. So Raj, you're a very different category to the other two, right? You're catering to a more market audience, not a luxury audience, selling in a more competitive, if I can say, FMCG kind of category, building through. The consumer franchise and the consumer you're trying to sell through is very different. The retail base is very different. So what's been your experience trying to go international?
So I'll just step back. When we started Happily Unmarried, which was a gifting / lifestyle store, that had a completely offline first approach. And we did it for about 10, 12 years. And then when we came with the idea of a men's grooming brand, we were very sure that we'll go online first. So we call ourselves an online first brand. And when we launched in 2015, our plan was only to be online. And that's what we did for the first couple of years. We basically focused on the online growth in India and did the right, all the social media marketing, all the digital marketing that Samarth and Palak speak about. And then eventually first it was our own website, then we moved to marketplaces. And slowly it came to a point where we started getting the offline offline demand as well, and then we started expanding into offline. So now we are present in almost 8,000 outlets across the country, and we sell in digitally online everywhere, every space that it is. Like you said, it's a FMCG brand, so our focus is to be as visible and as present in as many places as possible. So I think you asked earlier, right now exports is about 10% of our total business, and interestingly, we haven't really gone ahead and marketed it. It's come to us organically or through, because we were selling on Amazon and we're selling well, they said, okay, you should register on a.com in the US and the UK and the Middle East. So we did that. And we also got a lot of inbound queries from the South Asian markets. So you know, the Indonesia, Malaysia, Vietnam. So we started selling a bit there as well. Interestingly, we don't handle the Southeast Asia market ourselves. It's done through a distributor, but he also is only selling. He's also selling only online in the countries that they represent. So I feel it's been a big change. And while most brands will have to also make a presence in offline, but having said that, from an export perspective, because it's also a lot easier to set up a business. For instance, when we're selling in Amazon USA, we are doing the entire marketing ourselves. We are managing the dashboard ourselves, so we get a sense of what's happening and we control that. Of course, so that's the interesting bit, and especially I think in men's grooming, thankfully, we're not seeing a very big difference in terms of trends. Of course, there are some local nuances in regards to, you know, the fragrances you like or the preference depending on the climate, etc. But largely, I think men are mostly same everywhere. So very happy that we didn't have to reorient our products drastically for the other markets. And our focus has been not just to target the Indian diaspora. We've been very, very sure that, you know, you go in like, you know, like what a, like an, what a Nivea do when they would launch in, or L'Oreal would do. So we look at it like that. And yeah, the going has been good. Yeah.
Fantastic. Excellent. And you've gone largely, when you've gone globally, you've gone on the back of, like you said, marketplaces. So it'll be an Amazon, another.
Yes, yes.
Or a partner in some case. And
Yes. So, but it's only through marketplaces and everywhere. Yeah, that's right.
That's very interesting. So I think, and you touched upon this point at last, and I would like to, you know, open this question to all three of you, which is to say that, from a consumer perspective, really, you know, what are the big differences, right? I mean, product assortment, portfolio, are consumers looking for very different markets, given that, you know, also from an online perspective, whether it's pricing, similar pricing across channels, the whole brand building piece that each of you have touched upon to say that, you know, consumers are interacting with the brand in a very different way in these markets. And, you know, given that you don't have physical store presence, so, you know, how do you really build on those differences? And even things like returns, etc., which are not really possible. How do you, from a consumer perspective, how different is it? And what are the big ones to, you know, people need to account for?
Do you want me to go first?
Sure.
Yeah. So the biggest challenge really is that, you know, the inventory is not, whatever is not sold is not coming back. So that's a part that you plan it a little better. You know, you only send your best sellers or your products that you are aware of. Because interestingly, what happens on sites like A.com, which is so brilliant, is suppose I've sold something very well in India and it has, say, 20,000 reviews. Now, when I list it in the US, I will get the 20,000 reviews even when a person sees it in America. And you know, the ratings and the reviews really matter on marketplaces. So that sort of helps you build a portfolio based on things like, you know, which are your most reviewed and highly ranked products. Secondly, you get to know what are people searching for, right? So I'll know among my portfolio what is being most searched for in the US, or say the UK or Dubai or the Middle East, wherever. So you know that as well. So you work on that. Apart from that, you take a certain chunk of your portfolio and say, okay, these products will go, and some of them will have to, you know, you'll have to either give it away free or they'll come back as unsold. So that becomes part of your P&L. You add that when you do the pricing. For us, we have not tried to customize our products to the markets. One of the big reasons is being that none of the individual markets are big enough for us to customize the product for them. This is something we are exploring now. Only, in fact, today morning we are discussing. We are exploring now for a few of our markets where it's become sizable now. You know, in the last 2 years they've been buying regularly, so it's come to a point where we can customize. But again, here the customization largely is in the language. So you know, they're asking us to put in the local language, they put in the local social media handles on the packaging, which we are working at.
Understand. And what about, like, just the assortment clubbing together or pricing? Is it similar priced across markets, or do you have?
So no, that's actually unfortunately not possible. What we try to do is we try to benchmark it against the prices of that particular country. So I when we launch in we get a sense of what are the prices of that country. Say it's a face wash. I know what is the rate at which face wash of most brands sell, and then we try to benchmark it based on that, and you decide whether you want to be premium or you want to be cheaper, so based on that. But our pricing, in fact, even in Nepal, unfortunately, because of the huge taxes and octroi in the middle, our prices are more expensive than they would be in India, which is not right, really, because you know, ideally it should be either at parity or cheaper. But there are also factors like that which come into play.
Samarth, Palak, any views on that in terms of?
I can go after Samarth.
Thank you. Well, actually, in terms for us, what we're doing is every country that we enter, we're going to actually build the logistics out there. So in terms of inventory, we're not going to actually send every order from India. It's going to be locally, you know, because of course you need, you know, our consumers want the product in 1 day or they want it in 2 days. So we're actually maintaining warehousing now wherever we go. It will be done by a local logistics provider. So in terms of inventory, in terms of, again, you know, like Rajat said, it's going to be guesswork to understand what's selling, what's not selling, at least for the first 6 months. But we know our best sellers. We know from our previous experience, because through our own websites, we've been selling in various countries around the world. So we have a bit of an idea of what is selling and what is not. From the perspective of pricing, of course, there will have to be different pricing in each country, you know, depending on taxes, depending on logistics, you know, depending on holding costs. So there's a whole lot of things that come into your P&L. But what we do is try and keep it within a parameter. We know that the consumer today has the, you know, the luxury of looking through various pricing, whether they want to compare India to the UK or they want to compare UK to the US. So for what we're looking at is we're trying to keep it within a certain parameter. So what we've seen from some of the studies that we've done and from some of the global information that we've got in our vertical, if you keep that parity within 18 to 20% of what you're originally selling in India, the consumer does not have an aversion to buy it outside, given, you know, the easiness of getting it and, of course, the timing. So up to that point, we're okay. Of course, we also look at competitor benchmarking to understand what are the categories that are selling, who is selling it in our competitor space. And so, again, we price it up and down according to that situation. Pala.
Can I, Anurag?
Yeah, sure.
So my problem is actually a little more complex and different, because, you know, I work with handloom, and, you know, most of our pieces take about 30, 40 days for them to come. And, you know, they're much high ticketed value items. So I think where my problem comes is I don't usually have quantities and numbers. You know, because, like, let's say, for example, if I upload a collection, the chances are that, yeah, sure, the first piece I will be able to deliver it next day or within 5 to 6 days. But the other piece or the subsequent orders will be about 30, 40 days. Now, for the customer to wait is a problem. Another issue that happens is because there's so much competition in the market, my competitors are faster than I am, and they copy it way more quickly in a cheaper fabric and power loom, etc., and they start selling it. So these are the kind of challenges that I have. I feel like I will be able to maximize it more if in case I understood the patterns of people buying, but I feel with a product like mine, it's very difficult because it's not a standardized product.
Right.
So in certain months, it could be that, you know, we're like looking at a lot of georgette red sarees being sold. And the minute I will have inventory for it, it'll stop selling. So then I'm left with about, you know, lacks of inventory, which I have to liquidate at my stores. So it's very difficult for me to inventory plan at all points of time. And that's been, I think, one of my biggest challenges. Right. Also, I think delivery takes time. You know, manufacturing defects are there because it's handloom. So how does one convince the customer that's the problem? Or, you know, that is something that's acceptable? Because usually on the internet, you have standardized products being sold.
Yeah.
And when the customer, and I feel like customers are spoiled for choice when they know there's a standardized product being sold. And when they don't get a standardized product from what they see, there's chaos that happens after. Or let's say, for example, you know, my delivery time is 15 days and the Weaver is taking 30 days, or even 20 days for that matter. Now, the consumers will directly go onto your Instagram and will start bad-mouthing you without really realizing that there's a lot of situations that attribute to what's going on.
Yeah. And you see consumers reacting differently globally versus in India for similar things, for handloom, for, you know.
You know, I feel like global consumers are way more impatient than the local ones. I feel like local ones, because we have been conditioning them for a very long time that this is handloom, it takes time, these are manufacturing defects, it works. Internationally, even if there's a little dot or even if it's like 5 days late, I mean, like, they will directly take it to the consumer court, which is not something that always works out for either of us. In terms of prices, you know, we try to keep the same prices. You know, I mean, I try to act delivery, but, you know, like Samantha was saying, there's so much competition in the market and everyone's just trying to, like, like up each other. It becomes very difficult for people, for brands like ours, which are very sort of like trying to build a bigger brand in the future. Like, I'm not in this game for a short run. I'm here to create a one-of-a-kind brand. And for one-of-a-kind brand, I need to create something. And I feel like what helps in my case is that I have a physical presence. So the minute customers see that we have a physical presence, I think they choose us. The minute they sort of see that they have been featured XYZ places, they know us. I feel like for many other brands which don't have any physical store and don't have a thing, I feel like the authenticity kind of is always questioned. So, I mean, lots of challenges with e-commerce. You know, at one point I thought, I'm like, why am I even doing this? But then, you know, it's such an interesting space for your learnings, for your research, to understand what works, what doesn't work. Because in many months, e-commerce will surprise you. And in so many months...
So you're saying that for a category like yours and, you know, potentially a system nuts as well, is that the e-commerce internationally is a way of sort of testing the waters, testing the market, but the true brand building, the true ability to scale will come with a physical plus presence. Right?
Has to be physical. It has to be physical. And I feel like, you know, unlike Samart, I don't think I can have my logistics in every country, which means that I have like to hoard that stock, and my stock is perishable stock. I mean, not even perishable. It's out of trend stock. So if I'm keeping, a CR of inventory in every country, I still don't know what will sell.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, I can't have logistics in every place. At the same time, I can't even account for what's going to sell because the trends are so different everywhere across the spectrum. So it becomes very difficult.
I'll come back to that question, Palak, on you on the operational challenge. I just want to get some views on. Do you also see, you know, international e-commerce as a way of sort of testing the waters, if I can? Of essentially building out a brand presence physically, or do you see it as a standalone model that will work and, you know, the customer experience can be built online to a large extent?
It's an interesting question, Anurag, because I think, you know, we would have never, ever before the pandemic looked at going purely online. In fact, we had drawn up plans. We had even found physical sites, you know, in London. We had actually almost ready to sign the lease and take a store. But what we realized is, and what we've seen, and this is, you know, I've been studying about six countries over the last 6 months. The online business has jumped up drastically. A lot of brands who used to be offline are now going online and are going to stay online. Of course, you know, there are various, caveats to this in terms of a brand being well known, a brand being well accepted. It's not just that you go there and you open it up and you say it's going to sell on its own. It's not going to. Now, like I said, in our vertical, there is a touch and feel factor. So how are we handling that when we're not opening a store? So it could be something what's called a pop-up. So it could be a temporary store for a matter of 2-3 months, purely to have people try it and then go online and buy it. It could be a lot of sampling. It could be events. It could be, you know, various things that you could work without actually opening a physical presence. Given the state of the pandemic, you know, whether there's a third wave, whether the vaccinations are going to work out, how long it's going to take, we decided that we couldn't wait any longer. We wanted to, like you said, it's a combination of testing the waters, but not really. We're expecting to actually do a proper sale. We've made the plans, and it's not only been our own plans, but it's been a confirmation from our channel partner who we're working with. They're basically the Nykaa equivalent of Europe.
Right.
So they've
right.
come back to us and said, you know, we're also very confident that it will sell whether you go offline or not. And the idea is to run it for 6 months. Let this settle down, and you know, like Palak saying, we will also look at opening stores. But I think at some point, it's not just about selling the product; it's also about selling a certain ambience, a lifestyle. Who we are comes through offline, so it'll be a combination of both.
Understand. And interesting, you make point that while you will be selling offline, you will still explore physical marketing. So the pop-ups will be there, the sampling will be there. Some of that through the partner, all of that will be explored.
Absolutely. PR is never going to go away. You know, you have to build through the various publications, you have to build through influencers, you have to build through, category leaders. The thing is, again, like we talked about budgeting. Earlier, our budget used to be 80% offline and 20% online. Today, it's completely inverse. I mean, today, it's almost 75% online and 25% offline. In India, I don't really even do offline marketing anymore. But, yeah. You know, when we launch, we'll have to see how that works. But the majority is always going to go digital in the future.
Interesting. And Rajat, is that something that you see for your category as well? I mean, or is it largely focused on digital? Because you work a lot with the marketplaces, with both Ustra and Happily Unmarried. And do you see sort of physical marketing taking, the need for physical marketing or the need for, pop-ups and local presence of sorts to those partners? Sorry, you're on mute, Raj.
I think our sense is that we are able to communicate a lot better on digitally. You know, for instance, even in India, we are probably running ads in 6 or 7 languages. Our customer care team is speaking in 7 languages. So, and you discover things don't get lost in translation, because how the products are displayed at stores, especially because they're not your own stores, you're selling through supermarkets. What you want to be communicated sometimes gets lost. We feel we have better control of that online. So, and that's something, as a brand has evolved, we've discovered it has our own language, and we are more confident of it being in the digital space as far as marketing is concerned. But at least in India, we know that beyond a point, when you scale and have a more bigger presence, then you'll have to look at the traditional media as well. So be it television, be it OTT, or when I say OTT, I mean outdoor, or even press. So after a point, I think it's a factor of, beyond a point, digital doesn't pay. It's too expensive to do digital. So then you have to start looking at really mass media options. But from an expert perspective, all our marketing is going to be digital and online. We're not looking at anything else to do at the moment.
Got it. So right now, I mean, you're very much treating it, if I say, as an export channel, there is opportunity, there is to that. Yeah. The stage of brand building in the market is still, you believe there is an opportunity before that.
Yes. So the thing is that all our export inquiry has been sort of we haven't gone out and looked for business. So at least I think in Southeast Asia, the brand has got a resonance. I think what happens in India sort of tends across our neighbors, because they are curious about India. When I say Southeast Asia, I mean even include Indonesia, Vietnam, these countries, where they look at India and they they follow at least our trends and fashion. So initially we were also very unsure, why will these guys, how will they sell our products, and it started happening slowly. But in the last 2 years, the business has only grown and grown month on month. So we understand that, which means that their source of the brand knowledge is from social media. They're probably tracking our handles, or they keep seeing our products. We get a lot of queries from people in different countries, when is it available, can I buy it from say Bangladesh or Nepal, or say so I think whatever we do, whatever we've done digitally has helped spread across. Plus there's an entire big NRI population which is also following trends, and they're everywhere, right? Let's say Indians are everywhere, so that initial acceptability is easier for us. Like I'm saying, even in the US, when we launched on A.com, it wasn't like that people were complaining. One was that the reviews, we got the reviews, and those people knew about the brand. And what they else do is that typically now the behavior is such that you hear any new word, you hear any new brand, the first thing you do is Google it out and see, what is it? Who are these guys? You tend to go to marketplaces and you read reviews. You go to social media handle and see what the people are saying about them. I mean, that's become a standard practice for anything now. You meet a new person or you meet and hear anything new, the first thing you do is you check them out online. So I guess that's, we're letting that happen. We're letting that organic growth happen first. I know that, it's not a very big business for us exports right now, and even beyond a point, even in say respective countries, we'll have to look at more of advertising or more of marketing, and then we'll probably explore the more conventional channel and then look at how to spend more money on it, but not right now.
Got it. And that's interesting, and that brings me back to the point that Palak was making, right? I mean, operationally, because if one was to invest behind the thing, right, I mean, what would you folks recommend as big investment? So is it creating shorter, putting up logistics there, creating shorter delivery times? Are consumers expecting much faster delivery lead times in these markets as well, and therefore supplying it from the local market, potentially trying to create inventory in that market? That would be big challenges, or more around payments, digital marketing, some of those. What would be the things to build and invest behind?
I mean, can I go?
Yeah, sure. That's
I feel like for me at least, I don't think it makes sense for me to sort of build logistics, etc. as of now. But perhaps better study, I think perhaps in a year or two when I have more data, I think better study the consumer trends and like then plan my back inventory faster. And I think, perhaps like studying that in a month of XYZ, what color sell, what price range sells, back up the inventory a little bit more or keep it on standby. I think like it's more to do with my back end fixing rather than sort of like preparing for a different country and perhaps even have pop-ups,
right,
you know, more frequently. So then my consumer at least start gaining trust and start sort of purchasing more and like creating the experience more so that they start picking me up over everybody else.
So how do you do some of that today, Palak, in terms of trend forecasting or figuring what's going to sell next? Do you work with partners there? Do you sort of buy research? How do you sort of...
I mean, it's all research. I feel like it's all internal research as of now. Like I said, it's only been 2 years for us. 2 years went in the pandemic. So, you know, the buying patterns versus a pandemic versus a normal time are going to be completely different. We've anyway seen a change in numbers from what our pandemic numbers were to what now our numbers are because people are now coming in. But we're trying to integrate all the processes or all the questions that people ask us when they come offline, online. So that even when they're researching, they can just sit at home and get it. They don't have to physically come to me anymore.
Right. And also interesting, you mentioned, I mean, you have a fairly long, design to shelf cycle. From a standpoint, and given that, and given the fact that you are making sort of low depth assortments, do you see that as a huge challenge in terms of overcoming building, or is that the custom that timeline, is that something that you see the 30-40 days coming down fairly significantly as you build this
business? I would ideally like so, and I feel that's the only way I can win. Because if in case I have a 30-40 timeline, somebody else is going to perhaps get the sale. So with over the years, I think in the next 3-4 years, when I have better indication of what's selling, what the patterns are, what the consumer are asking, perhaps I will be able to better, like I said, manage my back-end inventory and my production and give the products then quickly. I only start uploading products where I have multiple numbers, but that will restrict my variety that I'm giving to my clients as well.
Right. So you are actually continuing to play somewhere between a custom build and a sort of.
I mean, at the end of the day, I also cannot spoil my brand. I feel like just for winning online, the 10 years that has taken me to get my brand here, I will not destroy it. Yeah. I will, like I said, Samad said, I will never get into discounting. Akaya does not believe in discounting at all. For the past 10 years, we haven't gone on a single sale. And online is only sale. So fortunately, I'm not driven by numbers or anything. I mean, for me, brand building is way more important because that's my greater vision for the brand. I'm not here for a short run. I mean, I'm here for the long, for the longer one.
And again, an interesting point you make, Palak. So do consumers come into your site or even for essentials that matter looking for discounts? I mean, do they?
I think now I feel like now everyone is so used to hearing a no that they'll just be like, "Persistent, like I never give a discount. So if you do want it, you pay for it." There are so many luxury brands who never go on discount, like Louis Vuitton for that matter. And people still want it. And I feel like we give up on a lot of sales during the process of creating a brand. But once your brand is built, you're sort of on a high end because people will give an arm and a leg to have you.
Got it. Okay, going back to the operational question, what are the big operational challenges, investments that one needs to think about?
So honestly, we are building logistics and we're tying up with big distributors who can do the fulfillment for us. So, we're doing that in every country we're going to, because, we can handle the marketing and everything, but finally, the product experience that you deliver overnight or deliver in 2 days is very critical. Because the customer habits have evolved in that way, especially the online customers, like Palak mentioned, is very fidgety. If you don't get the product in 2 days, 3 days, we see the drop rate or see the order cancellation rate spike up if the delivery is not fast. So it's really important that the delivery is quick. Secondly, so we are tying up with logistical and warehousing partners who can do that piece for us, and then we are focusing on the digital marketing, and you know, looking at, and also then there's a bit of inventory planning where you look at what is being searched for. You know, really, if you're a new brand and entering a new country, it becomes critical that you at least have some presence in products which are being most frequently searched for. Because then it gives you easier, at least you get some trial. You know, there'll be people who say, okay, this looks decent. I'm looking for a hair oil, and this is a good hair oil. It's got decent reviews, so I don't mind trying it. So that's our strategy, and then build it over. So that's how we are looking at it. But the logistical tie-ups are critical, at least in the FMCG business, as I see it.
And what about things like returns, right? Because I mean, is that a large portion? Do you allow that globally? And is that something that you manage through the logistics partners as well? Because
So till now, returns have not been substantial. I mean, it's, the percentage of returns is lower overseas than in India. And what we do is we have factored that, and we also sometimes look at return or unsold stock as a sampling. So you know, you give it free to customers who are already buying something. Or just distribute it, so that it doesn't come back. So it's something that you have to account for in your P&L or while you're planning the pricing.
Got it.
But it's far, far less than what it is in India. India's returns are way higher.
Interesting. Samrat, any?
Yeah, well, I think operationally, you know, if you're talking about setting up logistically or you're talking about expenses on digital, I think every brand has to have a different approach, because obviously, you know, it's a different product, it's a different, you know, strategy. For us, you know, when we enter, now we've given this a lot of thought, like we're talking about the UK, there are substantial investments that have to be made, because there are two, three things. One is that, like I said, in terms of selling a product, when you physically enter a country and when you're shipping out from India, there's a very big difference. Right. Once you're physically in that country, you have to comply with the local regulations, the local laws. So whether it's in terms of returns, whether it's in terms of refunds, whether it's in terms of data privacy, all of that, and especially the EU and the UK have the highest standards across the world. So the fact is that you have to comply with each of those regulations. So if someone wants to return it, there are no questions asked, or in terms of data privacy. So from that perspective, we've decided that wherever we go, it's a long-term strategy for us. So we are investing in logistics. We're investing, you know, like Rajat said, we have to get that product to someone's hands within 24 hours or 48 hours, because there are other brands out there. You know, you're building a business. In terms of returns, I have to take the returns. So I have to have a warehouse which can accept the returns. And like, you know, I can't bring it back into the country. So whether it's a loss, whether it's what we do with it, is all the questions that we will learn along the way as we go. In terms of building the brand, you know, while you have to be prudent about it and you have to be careful about where every, you know, rupee goes, it's something that you have to build. So whether it's in terms of PR, whether it's in terms of, you know, you're working with your channel partners, whether it's a digital marketing, there are certain spends, because it's not just a volume game, it's a brand building game. You have to balance it out so that you get a volume that allows you to operate in that country, but also with no risk to your brand, because for us, it's only brand. So if everything else doesn't work, that's okay, but we will never compromise on the brand perspective.
Interesting. That's very, and just as a follow on to that, in terms of partners that you work with, right? Partners, whether it's agencies, whether it's logistics partners, would you say in most cases it is local partners that you're working with, or are there Indian partners who've sort of expanded with you and are looking to go, or are there partners available? And either or case, are there good partners available to work for things like you?
Actually, no, because you know, every country you go to has its own nuances, has its own idiosyncrasies, has its own marketing. So even in England, while you might say English is spoken there, it's spoken differently. You know, so it's actually very interesting. So what we've done is we're going to pick local partners everywhere we go, whether it's in terms of PR, whether it's logistics, whether it's, you know, even legal. So all of that has to be done country by country. So everywhere we go, we'll have to have their own partnerships. Luckily, we have a global partnership with the Estee Lauder Group. So, you know, they already operate in 100 countries. So for me to set up infrastructure, I already have references for every single thing that I need to go and do.
Excellent. And I think given a period of time, I think there is one question that I would like to pick, and this is Samarth, you mentioned that right at the start, you know, there was around profitability, right? is it really profitable, more profitable to go international on e-commerce and sell, or given pricing, or is it something that you would recommend going in only from a market expansion testing standpoint, profitability wise it comes down to similar or worse off?
Anurag, it's a tough question. Obviously it depends on your margins and how things work and what you spend. But if I was to give you a generalized opinion on this, I don't think anybody, if they do it correctly or go for a long-term point of view, is going to make money for the first 3 years. We've looked at our P&Ls in different ways, and what we've seen is that on a fantastic note, it could be two and a half years. On a terrible note, it could be 3.5 years. But we feel that's the time you need to invest money into the brand, build up your infrastructure. You know, even if you do good volumes, I don't think you will start seeing return for the first 3 years. On an average.
Which to some extent on a new market, I mean, or even on a new store, you would say 12 to 18 months. So which is the, you know, build out period for that. But on a steady state basis, would you say that it would get to a similar place? You see, store operations and e-commerce side getting to a similar level of profitability?
We should hope so. I mean, obviously it depends on how the brand does, what the response is. But if you were to look at all things taken in consideration, I think, you know, the 2.5 to 3 year period is where you look at it. I mean, I would say 24 months to maybe, you know, to maybe another 6 months after. So 24 to 30 months would be a good situation.
Rajat, Palak, Martin.
Okay, right now, honestly, we are looking at we are trying to just make sure that we don't lose money in our overseas business. That's the bottom line. And if something comes home, very good, because we use that money to channelize our growth in India. So right. For us, that still remains a priority, and that's why, you know, we're not spending too much money, big bucks in promotion or digital marketing. We're relying on conventional online selling wisdom and keeping our overheads low, and obviously tying up with strong local partners who have the wherewithal to do good online selling. But Samar's point is right. If you are going to invest and enter a country like a brand would, so for instance, if Ustra was to open Ustra as a brand in any country, then we would look at a long term view, and we would spend money in building the brand like we've done in India. And even in India, it'll take that kind of amount to sort of come close to a break even. If you want to build it up, in a meaningful way.
No, I mean, like, I feel like I'm very conservative with my spending. Also because I'm testing the market and, you know, testing the waters. And I mean, like, I'm genuinely, in general, conservative with my spending. So I'm getting good returns and I'm trying to make profit every single month. But I do know that if I have to scale up, I will have to burn some money to reach wide. So right now, I mean, like, I'm spending less to get a smaller reach. But I have been advised by many people that yes, you do want to buy the reach, and like Samar says, you have to burn money for a couple of months, for about a couple of years rather, and then get the returns. And I feel like that's like most.
On a side basis, you would say between domestic and international is as profitable or more profitable in terms of doing.
I mean, I look at e-commerce as a whole, right? So while I get India, I also get international. So I'm looking at it as a whole at this point. I'm not dividing between international and national. But of course, international is way more expensive because returns are more expensive. Ship it there is more expensive. You know, sometimes we incur duties, that's more expensive. So it turns out to be more expensive. In India is cheap because, you know, it's just at the back of our hand and, you know, we can sort of, shipping is cheaper. Picking up is cheaper. Like international, the whole game changes because it's very expensive.
Got it. Excellent. I think we have time for today. So thank you very much, folks. Thanks for the
thank you very much
discussion.
Thank you, Lord. Nice talking to you. Nice.
Good luck to all of you.
Thank you.
See you later. Bye, Rajat. Thank you.
Bye, see you.
Bye. Bye. Bye.
Bye. Bye.